Hey, welcome to Woodwork for Humans, the series where we make great things out of wood using the bare minimum tools. And let me tell you, there have been a lot of changes in this shop. This corner used to have my table saw, my dust collector, and just a mess of scrap wood over here. So I got some help, cleaned out all the junk, built some fast storage, organized the sheet goods, wheeled out the machinery, and what I'm left with is this space. 12 feet long by 8 feet wide. Because I know that most of my viewers don't have a big basement shop like I do. Most of you are working in a spare room or a corner of your garage if you're lucky. And I should try to keep myself to the same kind of space that you guys have. So I'm gonna do all the Woodwork for Humans videos right in this small area. And I've got all sorts of plans for how we're gonna fit it out to be a complete hand tool woodworking shop. But in the meantime, let's do a project. On today's video, we're gonna get started on a simple but attractive storage box. And we're gonna join the corners together using dovetails. I know, dovetails seem advanced, they freak a lot of people out. I'm sure a lot of people are saying, I don't know, I've never done those before. Well, guess what? I pretty much haven't either. None of my custom clients ever wanted dovetails, and I don't really do a lot of casework or drawers, so I didn't have a lot of reason to learn the joint. I've kind of messed around with it a little bit, but I'm certainly not a master. But that's okay. We're gonna use a simplified version of the joint and some easy, approachable techniques. And I'm just gonna learn along with you. I'll be a beginner too. And I think that's okay, because I didn't call this channel Rex is the Expert on Everything. I gave this channel a much better name. For the stock of this project, I'm gonna use some white pine board from the big box store. It's already got square faces and edges, and that limits the amount of stock prep I have to do. Now I do need very square and even ends of my boards to do good joinery. I'm gonna blow through these cross cuts really fast with my big DeWalt cross cut saw. You can see how I support the board near the end of the cut to minimize any tear out. And for each component, I only measure the first piece. Then I mark the second component directly off of the first one. This saves time, and I can't possibly get the measurement wrong. Now, because I used a rough saw, my pieces are quite ragged, and I'm gonna need to clean these up and make them perfectly straight and square for joinery. This is the perfect job for my shooting board. I built this 2 weeks ago, and there's a complete build video and plans available on my website. Using this shooting board combined with my new Grizzly smoothing plane, I can get perfectly flat 90 degree ends. They're gonna be just right for joinery. For each component, I'm gonna start by getting one end straight and square. Then I'll flip it, square, and clean up the other end. Now, I need both components to match perfectly. So I'll put the two together and see how much material I have to remove. I'll shoot one end, and then I'll shoot the other end, slowly sneaking up on my first component until the two are perfectly flush. When they're really even to the touch, then they're good enough for joinery. Let's take a second and review the parts of our joint so that we know what we're talking about. To make this joint as simple as possible, we're gonna do one big tail and two small half pins on either side. Let me go over the parts. This part is the tail because it literally looks like a bird's tail. It has angled cuts down the side and then square perpendicular cuts in from either end. Now right in here, this negative space is gonna be filled in by the other board. This space is called the pins. Technically on this project, these are gonna be half pins because they're located all the way at the end of the board. So here's my pin board, and you can see how my pin board fits right in with my tail board to create the finished joint. Even if you're just doing a simple dovetail like the one we're doing here, you wanna be very careful with the layout. It's the secret to the whole joint. Start by setting your marking gauge to the exact thickness of your board, and then strike that thickness across the face of all the boards in the project. On the long sides, where I'm gonna be putting my tails, I carry this line around the edge so I can saw out the space where the pins are going to go. Then I'm also gonna reset my gauge to about half an inch and mark a line perpendicular down the board. This is gonna allow me to have larger, stronger pins, and it'll make more sense in just a second. Now, I'm gonna lay out my tails. You can use a cheap protractor set to about 60 degrees, and that'll work great. I'm gonna use a bevel gauge at the same setting. It's just more convenient, and I already own a bunch of them. I'm gonna set my bevel at the perpendicular gauge line I just made and mark the angle for my tails. I'll do that on all of my boards, and then carry that line across the top of the board with my tri-square. Now it's time to saw out the waste around the tails. Now, I'm constantly refining my technique with this Ryoba saw, and one of the things I've learned from my viewers is to only cut what you can see and to cut everything as a series of triangles. So I'll start with my fine cross-cut teeth and saw along both lines at once, the top and the side facing me. I'll continue that line until I've reached the corner on both edges, and I'll switch to the rip teeth once the kerf is established. That's going to make the cut a lot faster. Once I've done both the cuts on one side, I'll switch sides and carry the line down. After that's done, I'll still have a small triangle of waste left over, hidden in the middle of the joint where you can't see it. So I'll set the saw perpendicular and carefully saw away that little bit of hidden waste all the way down to my gauge line. Finally, I'll flip the piece 90 degrees in my vise and saw it down my shoulders. These cuts need light cleanup with a chisel for squareness, but it's quick and they're done. Once all my tails are cut, I can lay out my pins directly from the tails. Now each tail is only going to fit its set of pins, so you have to label the joints and keep them straight. I'm going to mark all of my tails, A through D, and then also mark these letters on my pin boards. I'll put the pin board in my vise with the show side facing me, and flush it up with a scrap of stock. Then the tail board is going to sit evenly and squarely on the end of my pin board. I'll use a sharp pencil to mark the angle of my cuts, and then use a square to carry those lines down to my gauge lines. Sawing this part out is exactly like sawing the tail board. Saw what you can see, progress by triangles, go slowly, and use the appropriate teeth. In this case, I'm using the rip teeth after I've got the kerf established. Now's a good time to stop and think about your saw kerf, because even though our Japanese Ryoba saw is extremely thin, it's still removing some wood, and you need to account for that wood in your joint. Now, when I cut my tails, I cut right on the line. I split it in half as I was doing my cutting. If I cut my pin board the same way, this joint is going to be super loose because I won't have accounted for the saw kerf. What I'm going to do here instead is keep my saw all the way in my waist. I'm going to leave the whole line in the board. The joint is probably going to be a very tight fit. It might not even fit at all right off the saw, but these pins are extremely easy to clean up with a chisel. I can just go in for a straight cut down like this and down like that and widen the joint up really easily. So I'm going to leave a little bit of extra waste on the pins and then trim them to fit later. Once I've sawed the lines for my half pins, I'm going to have to chisel out the waste in between them. Now, I'm using a holdfast here because it's quick and I own them, but you can also use clamps. They work just as well. Put a 3/4 chisel flat on the board and pull it toward yourself until you feel it slide into your gauge line. Then give it a light tap with the mallet. You're just establishing your line here. If you hit it too hard, the bevel of the chisel is going to push that line back, and it's going to put a gap in your joint. So be really gentle at this stage. Next, you're going to go in for an angled cut with the chisel. That's going to give you relief and room for the bevel so the chisel can go deeper on your next cut. Then go back to perpendicular and give it a couple of firmer taps, but still not too hard. Continue going back and forth between perpendicular cuts and relief cuts until you're about halfway through your board. Then flip it over and repeat that process on the other side. Once you've chopped in from both sides, your waste should pop out fairly easily, and you can go in with the chisel and clean up any fibers that are still sticking up in that joint. Now it's time to test fit the joint. You can see some torn end grain in between my half tails. Pine is squishy and it's easy to tear the grain, but I was also being too aggressive with my chopping cuts. My lines are good, so you're not going to see it, but I'm still going to work on this part of my technique and make it more precise for future joints. My joint fits too tightly, but my pins only need a very light trim, and then my tail board drops right in between them. I'm going to repeat this process for my other three joints, and then I'll be ready for test assembly. So here is my assembled box, and I'll be honest, pretty happy with it. Most of the joints look nice and pretty tight. Some of them are a little bit more gappy and not quite as nice, but that's not a super big deal. I'm going to be assembling this with glue and clamps, and that's going to close up some of those gaps, and I've got a bunch more tricks I can use to hide little mistakes and get a good finished product. Next week, we're going to take this basic frame, clean it up, assemble it, add a top and bottom and hardware and a few other decorative details to turn this into a piece we can really be proud of. Now, my dovetails turned out okay. Not amazing, but okay. Maybe yours didn't even turn out this good. Well, the important thing about that is cut yourself a break. The dovetail is one of the most difficult joints in woodworking, and the important thing is to get started. Because once you get started, you get better almost inevitably. You just keep practicing, and you'll improve. We'll improve together. There's a lot that I need to work on. So keep coming back as we get better at this joint and learn a bunch of other awesome hand tool skills in the Woodwork for Humans series. And before I go, I've always got to thank my patrons on Patreon. These people who support my channel, they've basically changed my life. One of the reasons I didn't know how to do dovetails before recently is I was so caught up doing client work that I didn't have time to learn new techniques. Now, because of the support that I get from my patrons, I can do something like take a day or two and just work on learning something new, then take another couple of days and make a video out of it. It's completely changed my business, and it's making it possible for me to share what I already know and then to learn new things and come and share those things with you. So if you'd like to be a part of accessible, unsponsored DIY content like this, go on over to patreon.com/rexkruger and check out the early access, rewards, and exclusive content that I have just for my patrons. And I never want to leave without thanking my viewers, because without them, none of this would be possible. So thanks so much for watching.